From Philadelphia, the city that pulsates with the beat and the rhythms of yesterday and today, it's time for the Geator with the heater, the boss with the hot sauce, Jerry Blavitt.
60 seconds make 1 minute, 60 minutes make 1 hour, 24 hours make 1 day, and out of that 24 hours, 2.5 hours are dedicated by the young teenager to the hippest show on the radio. So without further ado, let's carry on through now.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, blast off!
Young teenager, gather around. Hark to the sound I'm a puttin'.
Let me say greetings and salutations to the entire teen population of this here fabulous nation. You're looking very good. And as you know, it is time for me to chat with some of my dearest friends in show business. And before I do that, though, I want to thank you all for being a part of what we've done up to this point at Memories in Margate. Saturday night was our last night for the season, but we're going to be opening up in the fall earlier and in the spring. Sure, I should say not the fall, because we're closing in the fall. We'll open up in the spring. And I'll tell you what we're going to be doing in the meantime. But, forgetting Memories in Margate, I want you to hear something that I put together, and you will recognize the songs. David?
I'm on the outside looking in.
Just the kind of people in the world.
Don't know what I'm going through. Standing here looking at you. Well, I think I'm going out of my head. Yes, I think I'm going out of my head over you. Most of all, I miss you so. Why must I sit here
in
my empty room?
Problems range. Coco Pop, what you gonna do? Come on, eh? Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to present this man. You heard the music from the very beginning when he began singing with a group called the DuPonts and then the Chesters with The Fire Burns No More. I will present to you, my friend, with our Facebook chat, Jerome Anthony Little.
But I'm gonna do it.
How you doing, Ant?
I am doing absolutely wonderful, man, and you look great and good to see you, good to hear from you. We ain't been on the road lately, buddy.
Well, listen, let me tell you, the last time we really got together was when we did the Malt Shop Memories cruise.
Mm-hmm.
And that cruise is not going out this time because of the pandemic, but we will be going out next year, and you are a part of the family. And we're going to tell the people out there, if you want to come next year, we have some cabins available on how you can get a premium if you mention my name. We'll tell you about that later on. But Anthony, let's go back to the beginning. I talked about the DuPonts.
Yeah.
I remember the song You.
You.
On Apollo.
No. Okay. Windley Records.
Exactly. Paul Windley. Harold Lindley.
Harold Windley.
Absolutely. Now, listen. So at the beginning, for the audience out there, you're known as the DuPonts and then the Chesters.
Mm-hmm.
Now, tell me about how you get hooked up with, in my opinion, one of the unsung heroes in the industry, a fellow by the name of George Goldner. Now, for you people, before Anthony answers that, George Goldner does not receive the credit. Here's a man that came from a world of Latin and started a label called Rama, Lily Mae Bell, the Harptones, the Continentals. And then because of the success of that and a song called G, he starts a record label called G. There you have Frankie Lyman, you have the Teenagers. And now, that's the history of G gone. In comes End, another one of his records, labels. He's got five different labels. In enters Little Anthony. How does that happen? From the Chesters to the DuPonts to George Goldner and Little Anthony and the Imperials.
Well, you know, it's like a day. A lot of these kids do all that urban rap and all that, and they do it out in the streets. But we did that in the streets. In fact, we didn't really have a name for what we were doing. We just knew that the groups that we heard on the radio were very exciting, like the Flamingos, which is my favorite group in the world. The Orioles,
the Harptones.
Pop tunes, all those kind of groups. And I was so impressed as a kid listening to that stuff like everybody else. Yeah. I was listening to, but I happened to be singing at the time too. So I was learning by listening my craft. And eventually I ended up in Boys High School in Brooklyn. And I had a couple of guys were singing, and somebody found out that I can sing, and we started singing. And this guy by the name of William Dockery, he was one of the students there, and he came to me one day and said, "Hey, I'm putting together a group, and I heard you sing pretty good." And I said, "Who told you that?" Got this guy named Buxton. I forgot his first name, but his name was Buxton, excellent tenor. And he had heard me sing somewhere. And he told him, he said, "This guy can really sing." And so he told me, and then he introduced me to William Bracey, and then William Delk, and we all go to the same school. And so we would practice sometimes after school, lunchtime, whatever. And all we were doing was the same songs we were listening on the radio. And that's how that was. And then we said, "Well, we need a name." And William Dockery said he was on the train and he looked up and he saw this Monsanto DuPont, you know, the chemical makers. And he said, and we said, "Monsanto, no, man, we can't use it." He says, "How about the DuPonts?" And that's what it was. And so we named ourselves the DuPonts. And we really, all we did was the stuff around the city. And, you know, in those days they had, you know, that
church,
you go in the church, you could sing social, right? And you could sing there all the different places in schools after school things that they don't have today. Oh boy, they should have that today to preoccupy the kids so they don't go out and blow somebody up. And that's what we did. And we would sing all these different places. Everything was a cappella, no music. We didn't have any music. And so we learned that we could be our own drum. So we do this.
The any rhythm tempo. Beat. The rhythm
right.
beat.
That was the tempo. That was the drum tempo.
Yep.
And so we started doing that. And at that time, Frankie Lyman and Teenagers were the hottest thing in the world. And one day we were playing someplace in Brooklyn. Not playing, but actually went out there. And guess who I run into? oh my goodness, Joe Negroni was there, right, and Herman Santiago.
Now,
they were at this place.
They're members of the teenagers.
Yeah,
the folks
they were running out with some chicks or something. I don't know what they were doing. They came all the way from Harlem, all the way down to Brooklyn. And they're running around. And I said, that's the teenage. That's, you know, and that was the first time I met Herman and Joe Negroni. And then I told them why I sing. And then we sang some songs. And they said, that's pretty good, man. And I told them how much I loved them. Now, fast forward. We meet a guy by the name of Winley, Harold Winley. He was just sort of a hustling guy around New York. And he said—
He owned a record company for the people out
well,
there.
Well, he actually put it together for us.
Yeah.
He said, I got this idea, and I heard you sing Most of All. That was our best song.
Most of All, the one by the Moon Glows?
Moon Glows, right.
Wow.
And he said, man, I got this song, and I'm going to start my own label. And I said, you're a kid. You don't know. Really? You mean we'll be heard on the radio? So, yeah. Well, we don't know who this guy is because he's small time. He really doesn't have the ability or the distributors to be able to really do that like you hear on the radio. But, hey, we didn't know. So we said, okay. And we sang a song that he wrote called You.
You.
Y-O-U. Well, he happened to know what this jacket, you know, his name was Tommy Smalls, Dr. Jive.
Tommy Smalls, he had the joint in Harlem.
Yes, he did. He bought that place.
Smalls Paradise.
Smalls Paradise. Yes. And he had, you know, he's the biggest thing in the world at that time, R&B, radio station, and I believe it was WWRL.
And sure also WADO with Jocko.
With Jocko, and there was WLIB.
Yep.
You know, I see if I remember all that stuff. But
Hal Jackson, you know, there's another name.
Hal Jackson, who I've got to meet and adore as a human being. Yeah. And
now
anyway,
for the people out there, these were the black disc jockeys who had the power because they had the freedom. When I do my radio show, I play what I want to play. Back in the day, radio was formatted. And when Alan Freed began, he also had, as you know, the liberty to play whatever he wanted to play.
But he wanted. He was the biggest thing in the world.
Yes,
know?
Yes.
Since he was big in Cleveland before he even came to New York to WINS, Wins, and on radio, whatever, you know, Wins. And we got to talking, and one thing is, so we learned the song You, and I forget what was on the other side. I don't even remember, but we recorded that. And he happened to know Tommy Smalls. So he came to us and said, oh, listen to the radio at this time in the evening and you'll hear your song. I said, really? Yeah, Dr. Jive. Dr. Jive. What? Like kids. And we all got around this little radio, because it's the radio, and there was the song You. And I got to tell you, Jerry, I felt like 10 feet tall. I was, my gosh. And here's the funny part. In the neighborhood, in Fort Greene neighborhood, you know, it's a small neighborhood, like all neighborhoods in Philly and everywhere. It's just a neighborhood.
Yep.
But then, you know, everybody's listening to that station. They hear the song, one thing gets out. You know who that guy is? That's the Jerome. That's Jerome. And then all of a sudden, the little girl starts showing up. And I said to myself, this chauvinist thing is really good, you know. And that's really, I make a little levity with it, but that's the simplicity of that time, how we got together, was just anything you did seemed to work. Yeah. And Mr. Winley opened that door for us to understand what it was to be in a real studio, what it was to have a real band, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And it was very exciting. It really, what that was, in retrospect, hindsight being 2020, that's a setup for us. That was the beginning of the growth. Yeah. The growth began then. Now, and the next thing you know, Clarence comes to me, Clarence Collins. He lived across the way from me in Fort Greene Projects. He knew all about the DuPonts and stuff. But he said, I got this group, and I wish you could hear us sometime. And we did. I did. And they were off the planet. I mean, they were good. And I said, well, what's the name of your group? The Chesters. I don't know where they got that name from, but that's their name. And I said, well, I'm already with a group, you know, the DuPonts. Mm-hmm. And we never talked together about it again for months. And all of a sudden, a man by the name of Teddy Reed, who was he was the owner of a record company called Royal Roost Records.
That's exactly. And he originally owned a record shop.
Yes.
He owned a record shop, and he was also doing some jazz things.
He was doing jazz a lot.
Yeah.
And but one thing led to another, and he knew somebody knew, and at the time, we said, we got to get out of this contract with Whitney. We're not going anywhere. It's not doing anything. So one thing led to another, and we went to Hal, and we said, we got a chance to go with, sing some songs and go with this record company called Royal Roost. And, we didn't get any problem from Hal at all. Mr. Whitney, I still call him Mr. Whitney. He was gracious enough at that time. He knew he didn't have the muscle.
Yeah.
So he let us go, literally. And that was unusual in them days. When they signed you a contract, you were signed. And he let us go. We ended up doing a song called Prove It, If You Love Me, Prove It Tonight. If you love me, really love me, da-da-da-da-da, prove it tonight. Well, Teddy Reed was also, now this is another story, but I'll jump in there. You would know what I'm talking about when I say the boys in New York.
I understand. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. I understand.
So they controlled everything. And Teddy Reed at that time was now associated with Alan Freed.
And Alan and also Jack Hook.
Jack
also
Hook.
Morris Levy.
All of them. Yeah, I met them all. I met them all. And so they had said, hey, that's a good little group there, And he said, I'm still talking DuPonts. And he goes and he arranges us to do this song. And we did it. We signed the contracts for our rules. And we did that, another song, I can't remember. And it happened one day. He came to us and said, how would you guys like to open up at the Alan Freed Rock and Roll Show? Oh, come on, man. I'm going, what? And they did, because they were all together and they were promoting something. I don't know.
And you're called the Chesters.
No, at that time, it was still the DuPonts, just before. I'm sorry. We hadn't gotten there yet. I had met the Chesters, remember, Clarence? But I told them I was still in the group called the DuPonts, and I couldn't get, I really couldn't sing with them. So months went by. I never really saw Clarence again, maybe in the street. But he never talked about it, but that happened. All of a sudden, we're going to open up in the New York Paramount. Now, I can remember who was on that show with the Cadillacs.
Ruth Brown.
Ruth Brown. Frank
Clyde McFadden. The Drifters.
I don't remember Clyde. Nappy Brown.
Was Little Esther on that show?
Buddy Knox and the Rhythm Makers. Man, there were so many people. The Platters were on there. They were the stars.
I want to tell the audience about those shows.
Yeah.
Alan Freed would do a stage show.
Yeah.
He came in, as Anthony knows, he came in from Cleveland. In Cleveland, he was known as Moondog. He would have the Moondog banquet dance, if you remember that, the big ballroom.
They still do it. They still do that ballroom. They were until whatever happened here.
Right. He came into New York City and became the hottest thing in the world. But what he did is basically what you see I do in Philadelphia when I put a show on. You use 8 to 9 to 10 acts, and you get a big orchestra to back all of the artists. So Anthony now is on the Alan Freed show.
This is Alan Freed I used to go sneak in to see.
Why?
I used to fantasize outside the Brooklyn Paramount. Someday maybe I can be that, that kind of thing. And here I am in the New York Paramount at rehearsal. I'll never forget when I walked in, and guess who was sitting there getting ready to rehearse? Frankie Lyman. And I went, and you know who befriended me? And we've been friends to this day. We always talk and on Facebook, and we look talk to each other. Jimmy Merchant.
Oh, yeah.
One of the original members of the Teenagers.
Yep.
And he came up to me and said, hey, man, what's up, man? Hey, what's your name, man? I said, oh, well, what group you with? Well, I'm with the DuPonts. I figured, who cares? He said, I heard that record. Was it you? Something like you did? I said, you heard that record? He said, Yeah. He said, let me introduce you to the guys. And he takes me over to Sherman Gaines. Mm-hmm. And then he asks Frankie, takes me to Frankie Lyman. You know, that was the beginning of our friendship until the day he passed on. I don't know what to say, Jerry. I can't understand. We looked at each other and we didn't know each other. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't the big star. He was a big superstar, you know? And he looked at me and I looked at him and we were inseparable from that time on, all the way to the day he passed on.
Now, Lyman records for George Golner.
Yes.
Richard Barrett, who sang with the Valentines. Louis Maybell. How do you now make the connection to work with George Golner and Richard Barrett?
Well, okay, now I'm going to move up, fast forward a little bit. We did that with the DuPonts. That was fun and all that, and it was all the girls and the whole bit. And then we were right back and we started. Really, nobody broke our doors down to do anything. Mm-hmm. And one day I run into Clarence, and he said, hey, man, yeah, I went to the show, I snuck in, I saw your show, man, it was great. He said, I met this guy. His name is Richard Barrett. And he wants to hear the group, the Chesters, right? And we lost our lead singer. So what happened, Ernest became their lead singer. I believe the lead singer was called, not Ronald Ross? I can't remember. But anyway, he wasn't with them anymore, and they needed a lead singer. And he said, is there any way, man, that you could kind of hook up with us? We need a lead singer, because Richard Barrett said we're good, but we need a front man. We need somebody that's a lead singer. Yeah. And he said, I know him, but he's with this group called the DuPonts. And so Richard Barrett told him, well, when you get it together, come back, call me, and then come over. Uh-huh. And so he came, he said, can you at least come in and go with me? I said, well, where we going? Well, we're going to a record company called Gone and End Records, George Golner again, who had all the record companies, G, Rama, all of them.
Yeah.
Actually, Rama did a lot of Latino, salsa at that time, mambo and all that. And he said to me, when he said, it's the same label that the Chantels are on, and this, and the Dubs, and this, and I said, what? So he said, if I can bring you over there. But I knew that wouldn't be right by the DuPonts to be playing that little game, you know? Mm-hmm. So I had went to Doherty and I told William Doherty, I'm going to go with this group called the Chesters, you know? And never sang a song, Jerry. Not one moment did we rehearse anything. But Ernest wrote a song called Just Two Kinds of People in the World. He didn't have a bridge for it. And he didn't really have any real it was just two kinds of people in the world. Why can't we fall in love? That's all he had, really. And Clarence told me, well, they want us over there tomorrow. I said, what are we gonna sing, you know? He said, well, this is the song. Hey, and he called the guys together, Ernest, sing that song, man. Could we do something with that? And I said, listen, man, I'll go with you. I'll just sing. Jerry, I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't even have I had no lyric. I had no, there were no verses.
But the falsetto sound that you
But that's what happened. There was a group called, what was his name? He did the closer you are.
Earl Lewis in the Channels.
Well, Channels. And I fell in love with that guy singing that high part. And so we got there, and I didn't know what to do. And I meet Richard Barrett at Gone Records, 1650 Broadway.
Yep. And 1650.
And he's looking at me, and I don't know. So I started going, ooh, all the stuff, you know. And all of a sudden he turns and looks at me, and I'm hitting all these notes, which is natural as drinking water to me. You know, it's no big deal. To him, he's going, what the? And he said, wait a minute, hold up. He said, wait a minute. He said, let me call George, you better come in here. Because Richard Barrett at that time was the A&R man.
For Bone and for all of the labels, yeah.
Right. So that's why he went after Valentine's. He went there because he knew George and George loved his talent. Very talented dude. Wrote a lot of songs. People don't realize how many songs that man wrote. Yeah. The other bad records. And so Josh comes in and he says, Richie, I remember his voice, man. Richie, don't bother me when I tell you, don't bother me when I'm in the office. What do you want? What? You gotta hear these guys. You gotta hear that kid. He said, go ahead, do that thing you're doing. I didn't even remember. I just, you know, off the top of my head. I probably improved it. Doing it. And I did something. And George's eyes were not like dishes, like balls. And even as a kid, knowing I must have did something really nice because he seemed to be excited. And the first thing he did was he stopped us in the middle of the song. He says, Are you guys obviously you're teenagers. I need to talk to your mothers and fathers. And I'm going, well, what? I want to sign.
How old were you?
17.
Okay, so I had to talk to your mom and your dad.
Last time I heard New York State, it was 18. Before you get him, I don't even think it was 18. I think it was 21. But anyway, we did that, and then he ran off, and he brought in this guy called Lou Galley. Lou Galley was the creative cat, what did all the whatever, you know. And he came in, and he said, sing that song again. And we sang it again. I'd sing all day long. Them days, I'm young, my chops is young, it doesn't matter. I'm singing. And he says, then Lou Galley runs out and brings in this girl who is a secretary, but they use her as an heir. You know, some people, you know, that they have that ability, and they can actually, it could be the secretary, but they can hear something and know, that's a hit. So she came in the office, and then Lou Galley's there, her, George Golan, the president, and Richard Better. And I sing it again, doing all of the high parts. And she said, that's a hit. And that was it. Yeah. We had to bring our mothers and fathers over. They signed us up.
But Tears on My Pillow.
But that's another story, how that came about.
I mean, so you're saying just two kinds of people in the world.
Was the first two. Was supposed to be the A side.
And it became the B side.
Yes, it did.
Tears on My Pillow.
Right. See, there was another song that Ernest wrote called Cha-Cha Henry.
Yes.
But they didn't like the way it didn't do anything for George. Mm-hmm. So he said, you got to put something else in. He said, listen, I got this song, was written by these guys, and I want you to come back and learn this song with them. And then one guy was blind. That's Sylvester Braffett and Al Lewis. Wrote all those great country hits.
Yeah.
And he sat down at the piano. He's blind, but he played the piano. And he says, you don't remember me. Da, 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 da. And I'm, okay. And I picked the melody up in my head. He gives me the lyrics. And then we go and we sing it for George again because he doesn't like Cha-Cha Henry.
Right.
He wanted to put the B side. Remember, the A side was just two kinds of people in the world all the way up to that point. Then we went in the studio and did their songs. And George says, did you guys rehearse that song? Tears on My Pillow, and I didn't touch that tune, nor did the guys, okay? And we said, yeah, we learned it. I don't even know it. So he says, I'm going to give the band a break. This other tune is not working for me. We're going to come back after lunch, and we're going to record that tune. What? And I just sweated beads and balls coming down my head. He told the guys, you guys go back and rehearse it and come back. We're going to record it. And everybody's looking at me, Clarence, Tracy, Nay, and all them looking at me going, we don't even know it. So I don't remember who it was said, hey, you know, it goes, you don't remember me? And somebody said, why can't we do, oh. Well, where'd you get that from? The Penguins.
Listen Earth to the Angel.
Penguins. Same thing.
Absolutely. Now, I got to tell you something, but the audience didn't know. George Golner was a dear friend of mine. You know, he truly was legendary for so many artists, not only for Anthony and Frankie Lyman and the Chantels and the Shangri-Las, also for Lieber and Stoller when he got involved with them in business. But he said to me that when you did Tears on My Pillow, he stopped you and said he didn't want you to sing it. He wanted you to talk it.
Well, what it was I was trying to be like everybody else. You know, I was trying to sing like, I want to sound like all the people today, you know, all the groups. But he said to me, he said, Anthony, you know, you got a really high voice. I want to take advantage of that. He said, why don't you sing your song like you talk? And I didn't know what he meant. I got talk. I didn't know I had a high voice. To this day, people still on the phone say, thank you, ma'am, you know? And I didn't know what that was. And he said, I want you to do that. And by the way, who's your favorite singer, male singer? And I said, well, there was a lot of, and I just came off the top of my head, Nat King Cole. He said, do you know how Nat enunciates his words and very clear and distinct? I want you to use that. Now chop the words up. Don't sing it like, you don't remember me. None of that. I want you to chop it up like, you don't, syncopate.
Wow. Wow.
Okay? And then make your voice light. And I went in there, and because we did about 5 or 6 takes. And after we came back from lunch, and then the guys put that, that way they could get away with it. And they did. And we went in and recorded, and I said, you don't remember me, but I remember you. I saw his face in the booth, in the recording booth, looking at me in the studio. He's hitting everybody that's in there. And I don't know. What do I know? I'm just singing. And he said, and they kept running it. They did it one more time, because it was a live band in those days. Right. And they did it one more time. And he said, that's a wrap. That's a take. That was Tears in My Pillow, as you heard it.
Now, the label that I got when the song came out just said the Imperials.
Yeah, that's right. You're doing your homework, Larry.
People didn't know that, but when the record came out, it had the Imperials. How does it become now Little Anthony and the Imperials throughout your entire career?
Well, Lou Galli turned it over to somebody in the department. In fact, I met that person years ago who was their promotional man. And he took the record to all the record people, you know, in New York or whatever.
Right.
They travel over the country. And he took the record to Alan Freed. And Alan Freed said, okay, come on, you know. You know what they tell me? Alan Freed had 2 baskets. He had 1 basket that he throw records he doesn't even want to deal with. Sometimes not even hearing it. But if he heard something and it knocked him down, you guarantee it's going to be on the show. Because like you said, in those days, you played what you wanted to play. There were no formats.
Yep.
The disc jockey was king of that in those days. And so the guy bought it and he says, wow. He says, wow, who's that girl? And the promoter said, that's not a girl. That's a guy. He said, my gosh, he must be very little. So they already had the record out for about a week.
The Imperials.
Lou Galli being Lou Galli runs and tells him, oh my goodness, he gave my name. He's calling. He's going to do it on the radio show tonight. Little Anthony and the Imperials.
So he goes on the air and says, here's a song by Little Anthony and the Imperials. George Golder goes crazy because he's got to get all the pressings and repress
everything. Yeah, everything. I've had somebody actually brought to me the original Imperial Tears of My Pillow before it was ever Little Anthony. People have actually bought it when it was the Imperial. Within hours, they changed that thing, man.
Now, Ant, what I want to do, because we're getting some questions here also from the audience here, but you have had 3 amazing careers.
Yeah.
First career, DuPont's, Chester's. Second career, Little Anthony and the Imperials. All of the wonderful songs I played. In the 60s now, you meet a fellow by the name of Teddy Randazza.
Mm-hmm.
And a fellow by the name of Don Costa.
Yep.
Who changed the complete career. Yes, and the way that you were looked at by your peers with the material that he gave you. How did that happen?
Well, remember, I told you at the New York Paramount, all those different people that were on the show, the Platters, Frank Alamitini, but also on that show was a group called the Three Chuckles.
Teddy sang with the Three Chuckles, Runaround.
Yes. And they had a sort of a reasonable record hit, something. And when Teddy, when I met Teddy, it was, you know, I was like, what was I? 16.
Right.
A year before that all happened, right?
Yeah, he had a major hit also on ABC Paramount on his own called The Way of a Clown.
The Way of a Clown, right.
Right.
And then we were talking, and his dressing room was next to my dressing room. They were next to mine. And so he would always talk to me, and he said, he saw me on stage, he said that I was sitting in the wings. He says, someday, man, you got a voice, I don't, you know. He says, someday we're going to work together. Someday. Wow.
So this is 1958.
This is when I went there, that would be, I was 15, that was
1955,
56? No, what would I be? I was 16, that was 1957.
Okay. Yeah, that's that time period.
No, wrong. 56. I was 15.
Right. Okay.
When I met him, right. You know, and 2 years go by.
Right.
More than that, 7 years go by. I never see the guy again except for the Ed Sullivan show or stuff like that. But we liked each other, just like Frankie. It was just something. We just liked each other. And all that time I was there for over 10 days, we would always hang out and he would take me, get something to eat. He actually came with me to meet my mother. And because it was a New York Prima, we took the train, and he took the train all the way with me, all the way back to Brooklyn to meet my mother. Right. That's unusual. But he saw something. It was something maybe. He told me later, he said, it reminds me of me. And he said, he used to tell me, you're going to be my voice. The way I'd like my voice to be, that's what, you got that. That it.
Wow.
And so that's how I met Teddy. And he said, someday we're going to work together.
Right.
Flash forward, the group and I, we do the whole bit, Tears in My Pillow, this and that. That's the kind of people where we had Shimmy Shimmy Coco Bop. And then there was a layoff and a lot of problems that it got to the point where I was, I don't know, I was acting too on the side. I was trying to do stuff, you know, off. I'm just doing stuff acting. And this lady came along and wanted to, she used to manage Jean Tierney, the actress.
Mm-hmm.
And she convinced me that I should be a single artist. You're a young kid, you're very personable.
I understand. You know?
And I said, really? An actor be on stage or be in the movies? What? And I kind of said, yeah, that's what I want to do. And actually left the group. I said, I don't want to do this anymore. And it became easy because Nathaniel Rogers, the bass singer in our group, really good, he got drafted.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was gone. And then Tracy, something happened. He had some misunderstanding and he didn't want to sing anymore. So I started thinking, why am I going to go? I can go off with this lady and be an actor and stuff. And so for 2.5 years to 3 years, the Imperials, Little Anthony and the Imperials were not an entity anymore. And by the way, when people always say, are you an Imperial? I was. But once they cut me out of the herd, I became Little Anthony. It's two different entities.
Yeah.
Like Sears and Roebuck, you know what I mean? So I sing with the Imperials, but I'm not an Imperial. They're the Imperials. Yeah. I'm Little Anthony. So let me lose my train of thought. Then, let me see, what am I going to say? Then fast forward, those 3 years we were off, I met a man by the name of Ernie Martinelli.
Who was your manager out of Brooklyn?
Yes,
he also managed
years,
the Chiffons.
For years, I mean, he was, he had the Chiffons at that time. And that's about it. His brother, Johnny Martinelli, used to be one of the top comedian agents in New York City. Right. Where I met Ernie, I don't even remember, man. He just, something happened. And we met him, and he said to me, I was up in his office. He says, you know, I ran into a guy by the Teddy Randazzo. You know Teddy Randazzo with the used to sing with the Chuckles? I said, yeah, a few years ago, I sang with him in the New York Prima. And he said, well, he's working with a record company and with a man by the name of Don Costa. Now, every kid, the word Don Costa, you immediately you think Sinatra, because he was with Sinatra all the time. And that's what I thought. I knew he was a big time arranger, pop arranger.
Do you know, not to interrupt, but do you know how Teddy got together with Costa?
No.
Teddy recorded on ABC Paramount.
Yes, he did.
Don Costa was the A&R director
for
ABC Paramount, and did Steve Lawrence. And
yes,
also Teddy Randazzo. Yes. So we fast forward now from 56 when you're doing this and doing that. You become Fred.
This is 63 going in 63, 64.
Right. Now Ernie says, Teddy Randazzo, Don Costa. Your eyes open up.
Right, because you're Don Costa more than anything.
Right. The name of the label was called DCP.
DC Don Costa Productions.
Exactly.
And it was right over. It was right where Roulette Records were. That's another story. But it was right down on, I forget what street it was, off Broadway.
Yeah.
And it was upstairs in the second loft.
But tell me tell me about when you heard the material.
Well, check it out. Ernie says, I met the guy Teddy and he knows you. And he says, hey, is he doing anything? He says, no, I just started managing them. We came back together. Okay, that's another story. We got back together. That acting thing was foolishness on my part. But we got back together. We're always friends. We weren't angry at each other. And at that time, a young man by the name of Sammy Strain was now the tenor. We all know Sammy Strain was many years with the OJs.
Yep.
He now was a tenor. He used to be with a group called the Chips. You remember that song? Down,
Rubber Biscuit.
One down, one dibba, hanging down, chung down, one dibba. The Rubber Biscuit. Whoa, Rubber Biscuit. Well, he was the tenor in that group, but he ended up with them. And another guy by the name of Kenny Seymour, who was really the genius of this group. And it was Clarence Collins and Ernest Wright, still there. And we went over to the office. He invited us up to the office and we went up and we were quite impressed. It was a really big place. And there was Don Costa. I was like, yeah, I go again, Google eyes. Oh, Don Costa, God dang. And he started talking and he was just like me. He was a regular guy, you know, regular New York guy. And he's just right. And I'm going, he put me at ease. And he says, hey, listen, go in the office with Teddy. He wants to play something for you. I heard you guys are not recording, so he wants to play with something for you. And I went into the office, and he played the song, Outside Looking In. I'm on the outside looking in. And Teddy's very, really, not only is a writer, but he's a singer. So he knew how to immediately relate to me on that level as a singer, you know? And I said, that's nice. And all the guys said, that's a pretty cool tune, man. I like signing you guys up, man. And so he called down in the office. And I remember that little office. It was really small and it had an upright camera against the wall. And he calls down in the office and he says, Don says, okay, listen, I'll make sure we're going to record you guys, you know, get whatever contract and record a couple of three songs. He said, I make sure everybody's out of their contracts. And all the guys said, no, man, I don't have any contract. And they looked at me and he said, what about you? I said, I do have a contract, but he won't let me out of the contract. You know who that was? Morris Levy. See, you're laughing. He knows right away.
Well, what I'm talking about. Yeah. let me explain for our friends out there. No, I'm not going to explain.
No, I'm not going to think you should. Anyway, Morris had me, actually threw me out of the office one day. I found I was in good company because the Shondells, he told the story in his book. He was thrown out of the office too. So I'm good company. Frank and I was thrown out of the office physically. So I'm in good shape.
And so you were released from your contract?
No, I wasn't. And I told Don, and Don said, well, who are you recording with? I said, Roulette Records, Morris Levy. You can see Don's face go, meow, boom. He says, oh, golly. All right, you guys, look, I'll call you. We'll call you back. I said, damn, they're not going to call us back. I'm screwed. I ain't going to get out of there and do anything. A few days later, the phone rang. They wanted to come back to the office. When I came back to the office, he handed me the paper. He says, this is your contract. I got your contract. I'm going, what the? How'd you do that? And never knew. It wasn't until a year later, just in some conversation with Teddy, and I asked, you know, it came up and I said, man, how did I get that? How did Teddy, you don't know how he got the comment. He said he put in a call. I said, who'd he put in a call in? Frank Sinatra. Played this song for Frank Sinatra going out of my head. He already played, we didn't even know about the song. Frank wanted that song.
Yes. Well, he recorded it. You know
yes,
that.
He did. Yeah, yes. He wanted that song. But Teddy said, no, this song is for this group. I got the Imperials, you know. And so legend is that he played outside looking in and he called him back. And that's what Don got the contract back. Now, when I say that, I do it in all due respect. He made a phone call.
Yeah, well, listen, isn't it better, today, a man's word back in the day was better than any contract.
That's right.
If you had a problem, you went to see somebody, and it was corrected. If you were right. If you were wrong, yeah. You couldn't go back into that door.
He had that kind of power. He can call on people.
Yes, yes.
Give Mr. Give me a call. So they can. That's how I got in the contract to us. And when Frank Sinatra heard Outside Looking In, this was the word he said to me. I told Nancy Sinatra about this. I met her. Mm-hmm. And I told her, she said, why didn't somebody tell me? I would have put it in my book. She wrote about her dad. And this is a true story. He said, tell a kid he sings good.
Yeah, well, that's Frank. But all of the songs with Teddy, I mean, mm-hmm. What was the inspiration? You and I know Teddy, and he was going through a lot of heartaches.
That's it. You nailed it.
Right, right. You know, and he was writing these songs that were heart-wrenching. Mm-hmm. And I said to Dionne Warwick, and I'm going to say it to you. Burt Bacharach, Dionne Warwick was the glove that fit perfectly in mm-hmm. Burt's hand. Together, mm-hmm. it worked like that. Yep. Your voice was the perfect voice for Teddy Randazzo to express himself. And every one of the songs were heartbreaking.
Yeah, but years prior to that, Jerry, he said, someday we're going to work together. And he told me, he said, you're going to be that voice. I sing, he says, I play piano and all this stuff. But something about your voice, he said, fits what I'm writing. I can just hear it. You know?
You know.
And it was because when I would listen to him, Teddy, we would go out some restaurants, have a few drinks, or whatever it is, and we loosened up. He would tell me stories about ladies. He was a ladies' man. You know, I was a handsome dude, man.
Well, listen.
I mean, I had a man crush on the guy. I mean, he was that.
Listen, I go back with Teddy. I was a kid, 1953, danced on a show called Bandstand. And the three chuckles came in and did Run Around.
Yeah.
And three Italian cats standing up, moving like that, moving. I said, wow. You know, but people don't. Look what you did for the Royalettes.
That's
Steve Lawrence, he did some great things for Sinatra.
Yes, he did.
He wrote some great things.
I heard them all.
Yeah, you know, I want our audience to know, because Anthony, we've lived in a wonderful world called show business, and we've always been friends, whether it's you, me, Dion, Frankie Avalon, Frankie Valli, Dionne Warwick, Dion. Our world is a world of show business. When you met someone, and if they connected with you and saw something in you that they liked, they would further you along. It's a whole different world today for young people.
No. I didn't want to get into it. It's really different in many ways. But at that time, what he said was prophetic. One of these days, kid, we're going to work together. Now, I didn't think about that till years later. And it would hit me. And later on in my life, I said, oh my gosh, he said that. Because he told me that this woman that he married, blonde girl in Vegas. She was living in Vegas. Mm-hmm. And he had two kids. One kid, I think, is Teddy Randazzo Jr.
Yep.
He had a daughter, but I don't know if it's the same woman. Teddy, he was a Rolling Stone, what am I saying? Anyway, he told me these stories. And when he told me these stories, remember, I was a trained actor. People don't know that. I did plays and everything as a kid. the Little Anthony thing came later. That's just part of who I am. And so I understood lyric. And one of the things that I love about Frank Sinatra, he understood lyric, and he also was an actor.
Yeah, but he not only changed you musically, but he also changed, I remember when you would come in, back in the day, you would be flashy at the Apollo. You were now wearing tuxedos.
Tuxedos,
a bow tie. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so interesting, the progression for a performer. And Bobby Darin led it. Bobby Darin was a rock and roller split
flash. I knew Bobby. Bobby was a pop singer before he even did Split Splash.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So when his heart was in the pop world.
Right. So, you know, that's inspirational for you, man. It really is. But then now, after Teddy, I'm going to give you another name on the same path from Philadelphia who wrote some wonderful things for you. Tommy Bell.
That's it. He
carried on in the same way musically, story-wise, as Teddy carried on.
Well, you know, we had one of the most prolific records to this day. It's one of the most, it's long after I'm gone off of this earth, man. People are going to be singing and going out of my head. It's just one of those songs. And other singers hear it. I remember David Ruffin telling me, saying, man, every time I hear that song, he say, man, he said, Barry loves you, Barry Gordy. And he said, boy, he would love you to be on this label, you know? And I'm moving up to something here, you know? And then back then that was the same. And at that time, there was another, Don Taylor, who was Bob Marley's manager.
Yeah.
From Jamaica. He was a Jamaican kid. I knew them when he was a kid. I knew Bob Marley was a little kid.
Let me ask you this question for the audience. We're getting a lot of questions here. And of course, I'm glad. How much time do we have, David?
We got 8 minutes left.
Someone said, and this is Janice, did you use a house band for your recording like Going Out of My Head? Well, you had Don Costa's arrangement for stuff like that.
We had all the people, that's Sinatra's orchestra.
Yes, the finest musicians you had back then.
Ray Brown was on bass, Six Evans on drums, I go on and on, the people. Yeah. It was just, the concert master was one of the greats.
What are the things right now, because you and I spoke about this, situation with what we're going through is devastating for a performer.
It's the worst. It's been there for 64 years. I've never seen anything like this.
It kills me because I'm a people person like you are. If I can't make people happy and perform because I feed off their energy as you feed off your energy when you see them, it's a give and take. It's got to be difficult. And I got to tell you, Anthony, the Malt Shop Memories Cruise, and I want to tell you people out there about these cruises, and I think you'll agree with me. These cruises are wonderful because they bring not only the audience together with other people, but they bring the artist with us together.
Yes,
you people
do.
Out there, if you want to get on this cruise, unfortunately, this cruise, because of the pandemic, has been postponed, but it is going to go on next year. You see on the screen how you can get, and you should get right away on the phone, because now you can get cabins at a reduced price. And if you mention my name or Little Anthony, you will get a reduction. But going back now to Anthony, thank you, David. Yep. Going back to Anthony, you will agree that these cruises are so important for artists, our artists, and the audience, because we all come together and relive what it was about, right?
You know what this is all about, too? You got all them people in that captured audience. They're all in the same ship. So you can't run away from the public. If you want to go get something to eat, you're going to eat with them. So you can't say, I want to be alone. You know, ain't going to happen. You know that, man.
We have as much fun as the audience does.
I think they do.
Listen, because you and I drink some wine. Gary U.S. Bonds, give me the wine. I bring the wine on board. You know, thank God for the Malt Shop Memories people.
We never were competitors in the old days. We did compete. What we did was try to outdo each other, But it wasn't any kind of animosity or jealousy or any of that stuff. It was your respect for the other artist. You wanted to do just as good or better than they did.
Yeah, and you would take a couple of steps that they did and move it your way.
Now, you notice, Jerry, you notice on the cruise, like, when every time another artist is there to swap to come out and do the show, look at the audience. Everybody all up. I was always up in the
Anthony, you know what's also wonderful? How many young people go on that cruise?
Unbelievable.
And marvel, because it was show business. Ladies and gentlemen, when you see these, when you're out there at the show, they're coming out dancing. They're coming out moving.
I tell you what, man, I ain't getting paid for it or nothing, but I got to say, I get, if I miss a year and I don't go on the cruise, I get kind of ill. Wait a minute. It's the best job I get to have. You know me, I'm up at the thing with the cigars. And
you're seeing all the shows just like all the other artists. You know? Hey, you know, I was just thinking of a funny thing that happened. Do you remember, I saved you.
Oh, there we go.
You were supposed to do the music fair, okay?
Oh, yeah.
I called you up. I said, I need you to do an interview with me on TV. And you said, man, what time is it? I said, it's about 3:45. He said, man, if you didn't wake me up to do what you're going to do, I would have lost the show tonight.
That's it.
Do you remember that?
I remember that clearly, man. It was like...
Man, so many wonderful things. As you look back on the career, what would you say? I said this to Frankie Valli, and we're going to get Frankie to do one of these chats because, you know, he's on the West Coast.
Yes.
Hold on. Brian says, going out of my head, great song. Any special inspiration for that great song? Yeah, the writer, Teddy Randazzo, who was going through a whole situation, okay? Okay, now, right. What would you say? I said this to Avalon, I said this to Frankie Valli. What would you say to a young person that wants to get into this business? Because it's no longer the business that we knew. There's no longer record companies. I think that we're being governed by robots like this. Mm-hmm. I mean, you go to a store, you got to push a button. You know, you can't talk to one person. How do you get somebody to get into this business?
But see, it doesn't change, though. The business may have changed, but the formula of the business will never change. And that is, first I tell people, it's like any other thing in passion. If you believe you have something to give and you have a passion for it, like, let's put it this way. You know, Jerry, and I can speak for you, you know, when we were young, we paid somebody to do this stuff. We did it free.
Yeah.
Because we just wanted to do what we wanted to do.
Reward that we got from doing it and saying, wow, they love me.
Yeah.
That's immeasurable, man.
Immeasurable. Passion. I tell everybody, if you have that passion, you'll fit into what it doesn't matter what generations. Because I've sat and talked to the old timers like Sarah Vaughan and all them, and they talk like, oh, ain't like I was back in my day. You know, it's doing it now, they doing all this stuff with the tracks. Nah, we didn't have that.
Yeah.
It's the same thing now. Yes, there are all these new things and all these confangled things. Mm-hmm. In the end, it's the human spirit, the voice, the sound, the pianist, the dancer, whatever it is, they can't get a robot to do that. They still gonna have to do it.
No.
So if there's any advice for anybody out there, is you have that passion for it. You follow, you learn, and most of all, learn from other artists. Never get to a point you know everything, because you don't. You don't know.
You know, I wanna say, how much time do I have now?
You got 1 minute.
1 minute. I want to tell you, Anthony, the love that you have in your craft is what's going to keep you whole through all of this. And we will be again working.
Oh, we're going back to work. I just don't know when.
But you need, again, you got to need people. And that's why I love the Malt Shop Memories Cruise. Because when
I'll be on that, Terry. I love that thing. You know that.
I mean, I love Alan Rubin, and I love Janine, and I love Jason.
Yeah, all those guys, man, and Rubin, and...
Yeah, and Timmy, like, the production guys.
They treat us really. Oh, come on, man. They treat us.
Yeah. So for you people out there, book the cruise. Not only do they have the Malt Shop Memories cruise, but they've got other cruises.
Yeah.
And also, Anthony, I got to apologize to my audience. You know,
During the pandemic, I was not able to open up memories in Margate, so I did the live radio show on stage. We were finally able to open up, so I kept it going until last Saturday because the weather's going to change and change of time. But I want them to know that I love them and that we will be dancing again at another venue very, very shortly.
Yeah,
and Anthony.
I mean, I'm on the phone with my son, who's my manager. And we're constantly talking. And what other artists, too? All artists are talking to one another, wondering what's going on. I heard there was a concert down in Temptations went to Texas. They did an outdoor concert because it's safe. People wore their masks. They're outdoors. You're gonna be okay. Just watch it. Do the thing you have to do. It's going to happen because the problem is you can't do it in Philly in the winter outside. Right. So there's got to be something. I attend the church here in Florida, and what they did was it's every two seats. If you're a family, you sit as a family, and every two or three seats, then something. That means that they may not get maybe a less than a third. Not even a quarter people may have not be there, but the fact is they will go to another service.
Follow the guidelines.
So it can work. It can work. We wear our mask. We do our hands. They give you the temperature before you walk in. Fine.
That's why I'd be jumping off stage at memory saying, wear your mask. Nope. Anthony.
I mean, that's the way it is right now.
Listen, you and I are going to have dinner very shortly.
Yes.
You hear? When we get done this, I'll tell you how it's going to happen.
Okay.
Listen, I love you. Give my best to your family, okay? And thank you for sharing with our audience the wonderful career of little Anthony, whose real name is Jerome.
Jerome Anthony Gourdine. This was Sammy called. Hey, Jerome.
Thank you, my pal. I love you, okay?
Thank you.
For you people out there, we want to thank you again for being a part of this. You're seeing people that have been a part of your life with entertainment in a whole different light. And again, I want to urge you that if you want to get on a cruise, check out the Malt Shop Memories Cruise, which will go out next year. Gladys Knight, so many great stars will be on it. Okay? We love you. Again, for the people who were with me at Memories in Margate, we will dance again. I'm going to find a venue big enough, like at Memories in Margate. I owned Memories. That's why I was able to do what I did. The weather's changing. People are not really going down the shore any longer and stuff of that. But we will dance. Until next time, the Geator, the boss with the hot sauce, saying, remember, keep on rocking. Because in life, you really only do rock once.